Hallo, hallo. Hi guys. Hi girls. So I'm Remy Forax and I will talk about what Java EE can learn from dynamic languages. So about me, I am an assistant professor at the Paris East University. And I am expert for two GSR, the GSR 292 about invoked dynamic and the GSR 355 about lambdas and Java utils. Basically, if you find bugs in one of them, it's not my problem. If you find them util or if you find them great, thanks me. And I am an open source developer about basic tools, so basically all OpenGDK core things like JavaLang, JavaUtil. I am a developer of ASM, which is a framework that generates bytecodes and a compiler and some projects that I am the only one contributors and the only one users. So I have the slide. It's slightly modified. It's not a slide for lawyers. It's a slide for UIs. I will show you bytecodes and assembly codes. Don't worry, don't worry. I don't understand them too. So I will try to first explain you what is invoked dynamic. And so the first question is, what is invoked dynamic? You will see why later. So from marketing guy perspective, invoked dynamic is just a way to make dynamic language run faster on top of the GVM. But it's not exactly that. It's not that invoked dynamic make the runtime faster, it's that it reduces the complexity of the runtime. So if you reduce the complexity of the runtime, runtime developers can focus on other things, like things that are specific for their language, how to optimize specifically for a language. And for Java developer, what is invoked dynamic? Something which is unuseful because you can't call it from Java. It's not fully true because lambdas use invoked dynamic. It's hidden. I will show you how it works. And it's a good introduction to understand how invoked dynamic works. So this is a small example of a lambda, the X arrow LO plus X. And I see it as a function, and I just call the function. Technically, invoked dynamic is not used to call the lambda, because the lambda, when you call it, is already an object, so you can call it through an interface. We have a specific bytecode for this, which is invoke interface. So the fun.apply doesn't use invoke dynamic. Invoke dynamic is hidden when you do the equals between a lambda and the interface. At that point, the function is transformed to an object, and we use invoke dynamic for this. If you take a look to the corresponding bytecodes, you have something like this. As you see, you have an invoke dynamic, and just after you do, I store it on the first local variable, and then I will use it after. So the for lambda, invoke dynamic is used to create an object that will wrap the lambda. How it works? It works in that way. In the dot class, you have some constant that describe using constants. What is a lambda? So basically here, for the compiler, the lambda is just a private static methods which is generated. So what the compiler does, it takes the lambda and generates a static method corresponding to the body of the lambda. And what Invoke Dynamic does is just call, you see the dash 73, it will call a Java method, and the Java method will magically create an object that will implement the functional interface corresponding to the lambda. So the parameter that you have just after are the parameter of the metafactory, and you have the signature because of the R0, you have object, even if in the code you have a function that takes two strings. And you have something funny, which is if you see the dash 79, you see that you have the real signature, which is string, which means that lambdas are the first functionality which are reified in Java, which is something funny. And you can take a look at the name lambda, lambda metafactory. Metafactory is a method. If you take a look to the package javalang invoke, you will find a class named lambda metafactory, and you will find a code that describes how from the static method you create, or how the code will create an object that will implement the functional interface. And it's easy. You just call spin an inner class. So basically at runtime, currently, because this code can change, it's in the GDK, in a future update, it can change. But currently, from the code generate a class that will implement the interface. And if the number of parameters of the invoke dynamic is equals to zero, which means that the lambda doesn't capture any local variable, any value of local variables, so you have a constant lambda, in that case, you just take all the constructor, in fact, take one constructor, because you should have one constructor, create the object corresponding to the constructor by calling a new instance, and then you have something very weird, which is you take the instance and you call method handles dot constant on it, which is something special, which say it's a pointer of function that will return a constant. So, yeah, it's a pointer function to a function that will return a constant. And you say, basically, when you call the invoke dynamic, it will always return the same object. Which means that if you have a constant lambda, you will get always the same object. It's an implementation detail. I mean, the spec doesn't say that. It's just the way the implementation works. And if you have parameter, in that case, you find the constructor, and you see the constructor as a method to call. So basically, if you capture local variable in your lambda, you will call the constructor of the inner classes that have been generated at runtime. So it's not really an inner classes, it's an inner class is generated at runtime, not at compile time. The thing which is really great, if I take a look to the assembly code which is generated, here is the assembly code which is generated for my method test. You will just see it's the first line which is in black, which is interesting. You have a move from a specific address in a register, and this address is just a reference of the Lambda object. So in the assembly code, the Lambda object is just a constant, which is really, really great. And after you have something stupid done by the JIT, I don't know if you can see it, you take R10 and you shift to find the class of the instance, it's the second move, and you compare with a specific address, which is the address of the class. So basically you have a constant and you try to find the class of a constant, but instead of considering that the class is constant too, you ask for it, and then you call the method. You can see that we will see this pattern many times. It's the way a virtual call is implemented. A virtual call is implemented by saying, I will check if it's the same class that the last time I have do a call, if it's the same class, instead of try to call the method, I will take the code of the method and inline it just after the check of the class. So the code is a little bit weird, which means that we can improve the code. Currently we know because why there is this bug and there is a plan to fix it. It's not that easy. But basically it means that a constant lambda is a constant, even if it's not perfect. And I will end this example by trying to now think, what is invoke dynamic? What invoke dynamic allow? Invoke dynamic is basically something that enable you to do the linking between a call site, between a specific location here where we do the creation of the Lambda, and a specific target which can be a constructor or which can be a method pointer to a constant or things like this. So it's a way to define the linking, and the way the linking is defined is in Java. We have a code that defines how to do the linking. So obviously it was designed for dynamic language. When you do a plus between different things in a dynamic language, you will try to find if you want to call the plus between string or the plus between ints. So you have to have a way to map for a plus that you can see which method you will call, but it's a generic toolbox. Basically, it can be used to do what Java EE does. So before seeing why it's a good idea to use invoke dynamic, let's try to see what the problem. Here is a stack trace of just a small example using Hibernate. You can see the problem. How many people in the room find that the stack trace are too big in Java application? Oh, okay, mostly everybody. I will explain why you have this gigantic stack trace and why and how to remove them. Mainly the way Hibernate or all Java EE implementation works is by creating a proxy at runtime. The idea is you want to call a service, but because you have annotated your interfaces or your object with some things like transactional or check things or GPA annotation and things like that, you need a code that will take a look to the annotation and do the job between the location where you call the things and the code you have written. You have to do some stuff in between. And for doing that, most implementation use proxies. There is a kind of stack, a stack trace, but of JBoss, AGB3. You see, it's exactly the same kind of stack trace. I'm sure you know this kind of stack trace. You have already seen this. You can even notice the number of proxy that was generated before having this stack trace. More than 600 proxies. This means that your application use more than 600 generated classes. And the other problem of the proxies is that the API of the proxies use object, which means that even if you use primitive types, at some point it will be boxed to go through the proxy and then unbox to go to your implementation. Basically, what you're using is a dynamic language. You just don't know. And just take a look to Spring stack trace. Oh, Spring is a little, maybe let's say better, because it doesn't use Javalong Reflex proxy. It uses its own proxy, and it uses a library called CJLib to generate the proxy, because the proxy generated by Spring are a little more efficient, but just a little. Why? Why we have that? It's just from the Spring documentation. You have a caller, and you go through an aspect-oriented proxy, and then from here, you will go to several advisors that will do the transaction, that will implement the semantics that you have asked by putting an annotation, basically. And all advisors are called, one calls the other, and so on, in chain. That's why you have gigantic stack trace, because they are all called in chain. And at the end, you call the target method. So your implementation is on top of all advisors. All Java EE, and it's bigger than Java EE, all Java EE-like implementation use proxies. They use proxies and interceptors, or advisors. You can call it as you want, it's the same thing. That's why you see gigantic stack traces. Maybe it's not that bad, because we all know that the GVM is able to fold a lot of coal in only one C-like method. The GVM does inlining usually. Sometimes the GVM does inlining of 10 level of coals. So even if we saw big stack trace, it's perhaps not an issue. I mean, in the generated code, perhaps it's only one method because we have because the JIT has fold all the call in one C function call or assembly function call. For that, let's just take a simple example. From now, I will show you how all implementation of Java EE works using Java codes. Basically, you have a container. From a container, you add some advices, my interceptor or my advisor, the code that will check the annotation and do some work depending on the annotation. Basically, usually you don't see this code. You use XML files to specify this kind of things. And usually it's really awful because you can't mix implementation. You can't say something like, I want the Spring security, but with the GBoss persistence or AGB persistence. It's really hard to mix. Usually, the way they are coded is, it's not coded in an independent way. Each interceptor needs to know how the other interceptors are coded. And the way the proxy will dispatch on all interceptors is specific to a Java EE implementation, which means that if you can't mix things easily. And then, from the container, I will ask for something that implements the interface given an implementation. Usually it's not given an implementation. You have to check an XML file, and in it you will find the implementation corresponding to an interface, but it's basically this idea, and this code generates the proxy. So from that point, you use an interface or you use an object that you think is your implementation, but you don't use your implementation. You use a proxy in front of your implementation, which means that you have two objects for the same role. You have your proxy and you have your implementation. And that's why you have to do things like inside of my business method, when I have inside of my transaction, if I want to call another service, I have to go outside of the container to be able to go inside of it. Because I need not the implementation, but I need the proxy in front of the implementation. And here is it's transparent. You call add user with some parameter. It will call the proxy, goes into each advice will check if the method is annotated, and if it's annotated, it will execute the code corresponding to the annotation. At the end, it will call the code of the implementation, the user service implementation. So I have take a simple example where you have an interface and a class, but it's exactly the same if you have only a class. It works in the same way. It's just more trickier because you have, instead of implementing an interface, you have to inherit. You create a class that inherits from, but it's the same idea. So basically, you have an interface, you put an annotation in an interface. For the example, the annotation is answer role and in check that the user which is logged as the role manager. But just an example. And I have an implementation of my service that do something stupid, which is just to increment a counter. I do something stupid because I want to see how the VM optimizes this thing. So I try to do not nothing because it will be perhaps fully optimized, but I will. There is something really great with static values that are not final. The VM doesn't do a lot of optimization. So it's just a way to say, I want an assembly code that is like what I'm write, and not something which is too far, because it's harder to see why you have this assembly code. So I have exactly something like this. When I call user service.addUser, it will go to the proxy, and the proxy is a generated class by the GDK that call an invocation handler. It's how a proxy works. And then it will call the check role advisor, the check role interceptor, that will check if my method has an annotation, check role, and then it will call the user service implementation to call the method addUser. So here is a simple implementation of a container. It uses the Lambda syntaxes, but it's just because it's shorter on the slide. But if you don't, if you are not able to pass the syntax, you just replace the arrow by a class that implements the interface and that provide an implementation for the method. So my container start with one advice, which is the last advice. The last advice always call the implementation. So the last advice knows that my annotated element is a method and call invoke on it. In fact, in real implementation, it can be a little more complex because you can annotate fields too. So you have to check if it's a field or if it's a method and do the reflective call corresponding. So this is my first advice. I will always do this even if there is no annotation, even if there is no advisor or advice. Then I have a method advice which I call a function that take an advice and return an advice. Basically, the idea is I have my first advice, and when I want to plug a new advice that will check an annotation, it will take the old advice as a parameter and create a new one. So I will create a linked list of advice. And I have a method getService that create the dynamic proxies. This is the Java code for creating a dynamic proxies. Basically, you just ask to create a class that implement an interface, a service interface, and for all method of that interface, you will always call the Lambda, which will give you the proxy, the method, and the argument. Here you can see that you have boxing. Clearly, all call through an interface which is implemented as a proxy will go to only one method that give you which method is called, the method of the interface which is called, and the argument. And here, basically, what I do is to call the method of the advice that will call each advice in the linked list. So here I have just created my container. There is nothing more in a container. And I can create my container, and I want to add a new advice, and this advice will check if the annotation exists and call the method checkRoll. For my stupid implementation, checkRoll will do nothing. Okay? It's a dumb implementation, so checkRoll does nothing, and my advice, I'm sorry, you have two arrows in one line. It's basically I take the whole advice, the advice that was registered before, and I create a new one with this code. And at the end of this code, I will call the chain. So when the advice will be called, it will call the next one in the chain. And you can see that I take the annotated element, which is my method that was called on the proxy. I try to get the annotation corresponding to the one I want. And if the annotation exists, I just call checkRoll on it. And usually checkRoll should do something like if the current user doesn't have the role which is inside checkRoll, just throw an exception. So here I have a kind of better container than the container that exists, because this container lets you add any advice you want. As a user, you can create a new advice as you want. But it's basically how it works. So now the real question is, how the VM optimize this case, exactly this code? I mean, it's a really dumb code because it does nothing. Just go through the proxy and the advice chain. Here is the code for the VM. As you cannot see, you have two methods. In fact, you have more than two methods. You have four methods. I mean, not four Java methods. You have four assembly functions, exactly. The whole code will create four assembly functions. You can see that the VM is able to inline a lot of things. Each call in your tree is just a call to a method that call a method and so on. So as you can see, the VM is able to heavily inline. Even if you don't see the whole thing, you see that you have a really big tree which is inline by the VM. But even with this thing, you end up with four functions, which means that the caller and the callee, I mean, the code that call your service and your implementation of the service will never be in the same assembly function. And I will stay a little bit on this slide because this slide show you some part of the tree, of the inlining tree. This is the name of this thing. And you can see that so for some method like proxy.container invoke, first you can see that the VM decides that it's a hot method. The method is called often, so it's a good idea to optimize it. The way to optimize it is to inline it. which means the code will be taken and merged with the other code. And you can see that there is a type profile. The type profile says this method invoke will be called with several instances of several classes, but here the code uses only one classes, which means that for every call, it will always call proxy container $2, which is one of my lambda. Exactly, it's the invocation handler here. But basically, it means that for every call to invoke, which is a virtual call, the interpreter has always called one method from one classes. So there is no need to do a real virtual call. The VM will just do a check to check that in the future, always the same class will still be used. And in that case, the code of the method can be put at the end of the code, and so on. In fact, the optimizations that are done are bigger than that. It's don't the VM don't do copy paste. Basically, it creates a graph of object and merge graph of object and try to move nodes of the graph. The graph is basically for each instruction of the bytecode, you have one node in the graph. It's not totally true because you have merging and things like that, but it's basically the idea. Which means that if you take your code, the code of one method and the code on another one, which is inline, will be merged in one code. As you can see, you have some two big methods. And which means that there is already an existing assembly code that exists. And this assembly code is already big. So the VM will not try to inline this code inside the code already existing, because in that case, the assembly code will be too big for the L1 instruction cache, which means in that case that I will have a kind of swap of instruction, which is something really funny, but that you don't want. So the VM can't generate one assembly code for the whole things, because the generated assembly code is too big. So the VM has to split it in several assembly functions. The main issue here is the proxy container $1 chain. This means that chain is the method which is used to call each element of my linked list, each advice of my linked list. The issue is that my linked list will have a class for each node, because each node is a different advice, and each advice has its own code, which means that if my list of advice is big, in that case, the VM will see different profile. I mean, a lot of. The VM currently stop at two profile. If you have more than two profile, the VM will create a new function. Exactly, it will create a code that dispatch and call the correct function depending on the value. Basically, it will do a virtual call like C++ does. So this means that the more you add advice to your container, the less it will be optimized. In fact, in production, if you take a look to the way the VM optimized proxy, you have more than 4 functions because you have this kind of profile pollution, which is at some point I may have several advice and I have no way, there is too much advice that I can call. So I will not optimize this. Which means that if you use a proxy, even the simplest one, you can't have your code that call the service and the code of the service that are merged together. I mean, it's not possible. So the generated code, as I said, heavily relies on type profiling. And we know that some call are, the word is megamorphic, which means for a virtual call, I can have more than 2 different methods of classes that I can call, so I have no way to optimize it. You can see it in the assembler. I will not show you the whole assembler, just the start. So I have my method main. You can see that the string are constant. The reference of the object is loaded in register directly. You can see that false is 1 for the VM. I don't know if you remember, but the call send 2 string and then a boolean. So the 0x1 is true here. And then you have a call queue, which is assembly code for calling a new function. Which means that here, if you remember, the service implementation doesn't use the parameter, but the parameters are still put in registers. Because the VM has no way to know, because the VM generates several functions, it has to send the parameter, even if the parameters are not used. Which is something stupid. So what's the problem with proxies? Basically, the code of the proxy is too complex for the VM. The main issue is that with a proxy, all call will go into the same methods. So you will lose all your profile information because of this. And then you need to query annotation or something similar. Usually the implementation do some kind of cache to be faster, but basically at runtime, each time you call a method, you have to check if the method that you will call has an annotation or not. And the notion of identity is blurred. I mean, we have 2 objects instead of 1. Which means that if you try to do your cache yourself, usually you just failed. Here is the same example using Invoke Dynamic. So in my main function here, I have not called the container, but bootstrap, but it's the same ID. I add a new advice. Basically, it's almost the same code. Oh, it will work same way. No, because the code of this advice will be called once. The first time the VM show an invoke dynamic, which means that get annotation will be done once by method call. once. And basically what she's done here is just to say, my advice is the annotated element and a method handle. The method handle is basically a pointer, a function pointer. And I will use composition of function pointer, exactly like in functional. You can do things like fold. Here, basically, what I do is to say I will call check role and then my function pointer. It's the fold. And for check role, I will send exactly the parameter. It's a partial evaluation which is done here, which is basically I will always call check role with the same constant for the JIT, which means that the JIT will be able to optimize because these things are constant. I will not use proxy. As you can see, user service implementation is created using new. I don't need any proxy anymore. I can just use new. I mean, I'm not in Java EE anymore. I don't need a container that will separate my world with the outside and the inside. I can just do a new when I want it. And at the end, I have to call addUser, but instead of calling addUser using a classical Java call, I will use invokeDynamic here. So I have a kind of magic here that says use invokeDynamic here. In the bytecode, you can see that you have two invokeDynamic. The first one is just the creation of the lambda, as we have seen. And the last one is the one which is interesting, which is instead of calling a method, we will go through invokeDynamic. And invokeDynamic will check the annotation and create for this specific call all the call depending on the annotation. So instead of checking all advice at each call, the advice list will be checked once, the first time you call the method. And this is the code of the bootstrap method. This is the method which is called by invokeDynamic the first time it sees a new call, only once. Basically, I receive the method implementation, so I receive as it's not the method implementation, it's basically something. You see the last parameter here? The last parameter is my invoke interface call. It's my call that will call the implementation. So it's a function pointer to my implementation. I can see it as an annotated element, basically as a JavaLang reflect method. And I will call my advice using a for loop. So instead of having a chain of call, each call will be done each after the other. No gigantic stack trace anymore. And at the end, I just return the function pointer. How the VM optimizes this kind of thing? As you can see, you have some kind of black magic in the middle. You have main check role and addUser, but you have some kind of weird things. It's just things for the VM. We don't care about this because this call doesn't count in the inlining budget, which means basically by default the VM optimizes 10 inlining calls. But these calls, the ones that are not bold, doesn't count in the inlining budget. Remember, invokeDynamic is for dynamic languages. You don't want VM stuff that interact with the dynamic code. That's why that doesn't count. Here is the code in the assembly code corresponding. It's not very interesting, but you can see that in main, you have a call to get static counter, which means that the code of the service implementation that increments the counter will be moved inside the main method. It will be one assembly function. And this is a stack trace you get. I mean, the code does exactly the same thing, but we use Invoke Dynamic, we directly talk to the VM. So we need something that say, instead of generating a classical call when you call a service, I want an Invoke Dynamic call here. And this is not something that we can do in Java currently. So this is my Java 9 proposal. Currently it works. I mean, I have the code that works. That's why you can see the inlining tree and assembly code. I don't write it by hand. It works because I use a tool that rewrites bytecode, which means you have to compile your code and use a tool to rewrite, and the tool will check all services and replace the invoke interface by an invoke dynamic. And that's all. But we can do better. We can teach Java C to generate an invoke dynamic when you need it. So the proposal is to add a new keyword named interceptable. If you annotate your interface with, or your class with interceptable, in that case, all the public methods are interceptable, which means that Java C will generate an invoke dynamic instead of an invoke, in that case, interface. And you can also annotate fields. If this is something which is implemented in the language, it's not a big feature. It's just an enabler feature. Because this is how to write dependency injection in one slide. It's really easy. You just say your field is interceptable, so it will generate an invoke dynamic. And because invoke dynamic is the bootstrap method, so the advice will be called the first time you see the code. And at that point, you can try to find the implementation. Here, I have stored my implementation in a map, but you can do what you want. Basically, as you can see, perhaps, in add advice, I will check if the implementation, the annotation inject is present, and if the annotation inject is present, I will do something very, very weird, if you see it, but I will explain. Basically, it's a field. The way you access to a field is to say this.field. So when you have a call corresponding to this field call, you have a this as first parameter. But because here I know that this is a constant, I have to drop the first argument. This is why you have a drop argument. I have to drop the first argument because here I have a kind of dependency injection with no scope. I don't care about this. I mean, it's a kind of global object for the whole implementation. And then I will call injection map.get, take the value, and see the value as a constant. It's a real constant for the JIT, which means that you have injected an object which is C as a constant for the jet. In one slide. How to do properties in Java? It's easy, you just create a public field. Oh no, no public. Yeah, public, no problem. It will generate an invoke dynamic. And what invoke dynamic can do is not, is instead of just taking the value of the field, we can call a getter instead, if there is a getter that exists. Which means that you can compile a version of the code that will do the invoke dynamic and later decide to add a getter because the code that uses it will use invoke dynamic. When you will run it, it will wire the thing to the getter instead of wire it to the field. So you have properties but done in the right way, which is stop to generate getter and setter. It's not the good idea. The idea is to have a way to say, don't access to the field, but access to the getter if it exists. It's exactly what is written here. We can take just a little time to think about what is the impact of the Java EE spec if you have no proxy. If we have no proxy, we have no container. If we have no container, there is no Java SE environment and a Java EE environment. There is only one true Java. Here is a summary. Java EE needs some love. I mean, from the VM guys, for the plumber guys, we have forgotten Java EE. We should just take a look to how it works and just say to the people that implement these things, stop using proxy. Proxies must die. And in the future, we should add the keyword interceptable and let's everybody write its own annotation implementation and be able to compose them easily. Do you have a question? Yes, no, maybe. Yes. I repeat the question. The question is, does XML serialization have the same issue? Everything that uses annotation have the same issue. Oh, you mean, if you do your configuration using XML file or using any system, it's configuration, it's the way you configure your container, it's the way you add advice to your container. I mean, it should be something which is decorrelated, decoupled. The way you do the configuration, you should be able to do the configuration using Java. Because in that case, you will be able to choose if you want an XML file, a property file, or a Groovy code, a Java code, anything that runs on the GVM code. So it's another issue of Java EE, which is the only way to configure something is to use or XML or annotation for doing the configuration, which is also something stupid. We should have API. Yes. Yes, you can try to fake, instead of speaking to the JIT. Oh, sorry. So I have to repeat the question. The question is, oh, I'm smarter than you and I can use agent rewriting. Sorry. You can use agent rewriting. Yes, you can use agent rewriting, and it will be a little faster than proxies. But you still will have the issue that you generate code that you haven't write, so you will have to debug code that you don't have write. And then, because you generate bytecodes, the VM will treat it as your code and not as something that the VM knows. Here, the idea is to use invoke dynamic and method handle because you can teach the JIT how to optimize. And because you're speaking the JIT language and not the VM language, it will be far better. Yes?
You're going a bit fast for me.
Sorry.
So, the impression that I got was that you solved the proxy problem by rewriting the code, sort of?
Oh. It's because currently we are stuck in Java 8. Oh, I mean, it's a kind of joke, sorry. But currently, you have at least to have Java 7 to have invoke dynamic. Okay, I have to stop, but we can talk later.